Good morning. I'm very excited. There's this buzz in the room on a Friday morning. You've all gotten yourselves out of bed. You've gotten here to talk about research. I'm so excited. Thank you guys for coming. I want to welcome you to the Curry School of Ed and to thank you for coming to this year's Curry Research Lectureship Series and the CRC Conference. This is our keynote for the day. My name is Jillian McGraw. I'm finishing my doctorate in curriculum and instruction here at the Curry School, and I'm also the co-chair of this year's Curry Research Conference. I'm really excited to be here with you all. This lecture series is sponsored by the Virginia Education Sciences Training, or VEST, pre-doctoral fellowship program, which is supported by the U.S. Department of Education Institute of Education Sciences. This talk today is also part of a full day of research activities in this year's 8th Curry Research Conference. So we're really excited to have you. The Curry Research Conference is a student-run conference, and it's an opportunity for undergraduate and graduate students to share their research with the Curry community. We have poster sessions, paper sessions, and this year we've introduced roundtables to get students an opportunity to share their work and get feedback from their peers and their faculty mentors. We're delighted today to welcome Dr. Cynthia Coburn. She's Professor of Education and Social Policy at Northwestern University. Her work focuses on the relationship between research and practice, including the implementation of policies, the use of data, and how innovations are brought to scale. Dr. Coburn's longitudinal research with K-12 schools has given us meaningful insights into the way research-practice partnerships can be leveraged to support innovation and to improve leadership practices, teaching practices, and ultimately student learning. In 2011, Dr. Coburn was awarded the Early Career Award from the American Educational Research Association in recognition of her important contributions to the field of educational research in the first decade of her career. Just 4 years later, she was elected Fellow of the American Educational Research Association for her continued contributions to and excellence in educational research. Dr. Coburn's work is a model for how we can bring together policy, research, and practice. Speaking from personal experience, her work has had a profound influence on the way many of us here at the Curry School think about the use of research in solving the real problems of practice faced by K-12 educators every day. Before writing this introduction, I checked, and Dr. Coburn is the most frequently cited author in my capstone.
And I'm gonna put that on my CV.
I attribute being able to do that to the power that her work, that your work, has in speaking to the ways that we can apply systematic inquiry to help understand the way that people make sense of policy and enact policy in their work. So we're very excited to have you here. Dr. Coburn will be talking for approximately an hour, and then we'll have 15 to 30 minutes for questions. If you have additional questions, you can follow up via email at that time. After this session ends, we'll have our CRC lunch and move into our roundtable session. So we hope you'll enjoy it. You'll enjoy your lunch and join us for some of the other activities today. And thank you again for coming to speak with us today. Yeah, thank you.
All right, so thanks so much for having me. It's really exciting to be here. I've never been to Charlottesville before, and apparently this is a great time to be here with all the new young leaves that are out and about. So I'm going to talk today about pathways from research to policy implications for researchers, and I need to start by thanking all of these people. I'm going to talk, rather than talk about a single study, I'm going to talk about a bunch of different studies that I've done and try to synthesize some of the things that I've learned. And so none of those studies were done alone, just a cast of folks that I've worked with in doing these particular studies. If I were to include the folks I'm collaborating with today, I need another slide. Because that work continues. And of course, the funders are important. They make the world go around. So there's a lot of interest right now in how policymakers in various fields use research in their decision making. Researchers are often wondering why policymakers aren't using my research. Funders want to find ways that their investment in research can be more meaningful and influential. And with recent moves, at least in the Obama administration, towards evidence-based policy, advocates argue that policymakers and educational leaders should be using the best information to inform consequential decision, especially when it comes to children and youth. So the vast majority of writing on this topic is normative. People argue how policymakers should use research and argue that they should use it in particular ways. But rather than taking a normative stance, my colleagues and I try to step back and understand how people actually do use research with what consequences. We're also interested in what happens when there are intentional efforts to promote research use, things like research practice partnerships. And so we ask, what is the nature of decision making in public agencies like school districts? What role does research play in this process, and how do intentional efforts to promote research use influence patterns of decision making? You know, our overarching argument for this line of work is that it's only by understanding patterns of decision making and when and how research enters into these patterns that we gain insight into the promises, possibilities, pitfalls, and limitations of research use. So, putting that a different way, our goal is to leverage empirical research to gain insight into research use. I find it really ironic that a whole lot of researchers who really value research don't turn to the research to understand how their research might be used. We have a lot of opinions. We feel free to write them and then cite each other's opinions. So diving in, in my talk today, I'm going to talk about the nature of decision-making in school districts, the roles of research in decision processes, the roles of external researchers in fostering use. I'm going to just do, you know, kind of little sort of snapshots, and then implications for researchers. And to do this, rather than talk about particular studies, I'm going to draw on a program of work that I've been doing for a number of years, two comprehensive lit reviews on research use at the school district level, a five-year study of decision-making in a large Midwestern city, not Chicago, a two-and-a-half-year study of research practice partnerships in three large or mid-sized urban districts, and colleagues of mine recently did a survey of nationally representative sample of school and district leaders under the auspices of the IES-funded National Center for Research and Policy and Practice, and I'm going to report on their findings as well. Because I'm not going to do a typical research talk, I did a handout with some of the quickie overview of methods for these different studies. So, I mean, it's not everything, obviously, but it just gives you a little bit of sense of the database from which I'm drawing examples and stuff like that. And I'm happy to answer any methodological questions. I love research methods. So, you know, feel free to ask if you're interested in the warrants for some of the claims, because I'm not going to, like, throw up a bunch of, you know, I have a few charts, but not as many as. Okay, so diving in. Most efforts intended to foster research use are rooted in the following image of decision making. A problem exists, information or understanding is lacking either to generate a solution or select among alternative solutions. Research provides the missing knowledge and a solution is reached. That's where we should have been. Next slide. So scholars of research use, especially Carol Weiss, who was sort of the, really one of the early leaders of this field, she did a lot of work in this area in the 70s and the 80s, they call this instrumental use. And when you read a lot of writing about research use, especially the normative writing, this image is highly salient. It's also built into a lot of funding streams, for example, the IES goal structure is really rooted in this understanding of research use. However, empirical research on research use, including my own, raises questions about this image. First, existing research suggests that there is rarely a shared understanding of the problem to solve. Given the complexity and multidimensionality of the social world, multiple potential causes for problematic situations and ways of understanding the problem inevitably involve highlighting some aspects of the social situation and de-emphasizing or ignoring others. So in our research, there is also often quite a bit of persuasion, negotiation, and at times conflict about what the problem truly is or was. The stakes are high here because how you identify what the problem is not only assigns blame, but it opens windows to sort of different avenues for solutions. So for example, in the second year of our five-year study of decision making in the large Midwestern school district, there was no agreement about why test scores in middle school mathematics was so low. Some argued that it was because the middle school curriculum was poor quality. Others argued that it wasn't a problem with the curriculum. In fact, the curriculum was excellent, but teachers didn't know how to use the curriculum. Still, others argued the problem was not with the middle school curriculum at all, but with the elementary curriculum, which wasn't adequately preparing students for middle school mathematics because it didn't emphasize basic skills enough. So as you can see, each of these ways of understanding the problem puts the blame in different places, but it also can potentially lead to quite different solutions. Second, decision-making is not a single event. Rather, as Carol Weiss taught us, decisions accrete. They emerge through a series of small conversations and actions where ways of thinking about problems emerge, and small steps in an organization set them up to a particular course. And if you want an example of this, just think about decision-making in higher education, like faculty meetings. How do decisions actually get made? People don't come together and vote. There's these side conversations, and decisions sort of emerge over time. And this is very much the way things work in public agencies. Small steps add up to a policy decision, whether formal action is taken or not. So this process is deeply interactive. It involves people in formal and informal conversations across multiple levels of the system and different divisions. There's rarely a single convening of a stable set of actors when a decision is made. Sometimes there's that convening, but that is rarely an isolated incident. Returning to our example of the middle school mathematics, discussions of the problem of middle school mathematics came up over and over in the year in meetings in the mathematics department, between the assistant superintendents and external service providers, in cabinet meetings, in conversations in the hallway where we witnessed when we shadowed people in that study. Over time, key decision makers came to understand the problem of middle school mathematics had to do with the elementary school curriculum. In my view, the least likely cause, but that's an aside, not the middle school curriculum or teacher preparation. This pervasive sense among cabinet-level administrators over the objections of the mathematics staff at the district then lay the groundwork for a decision to purchase supplementary basic skills curriculum in elementary school. Third, decision-making in school district is focused on a wide range of issues. Returning to our diagram, the current conversation about research use seems to be focused mainly on decisions related to selecting or adopting curriculum, materials, or programs. Thus, there's been an enormous effort to improve the quality of efficacy studies, a lot of federal money being devoted to randomized control trials of curriculum materials or instructional programs of various types. And this emphasis emerges from the translational research paradigm, where a vision of research practice involves conducting basic research, which leads to efficacious interventions to more widespread adoption of research-based tools and approaches. But this policy approach and the broader discussion is focused on a narrow range of problems that district leaders face, which is selecting the right materials or the right programs. And certainly, that's a problem that district leaders grapple with in states. But our research finds that district officials are involved in a much broader range of decision making. For example, in our three-district study, we observed district leaders designing their own policies and programs, creating implementation plans for those initiatives, and also creating implementation plans when they adopted curriculum, developing professional development plans, deciding how to support low-performing schools, deciding where to build a new school, where to close schools when their enrollment declined, and discussing whether and how to end programs or terminate providers. So this is just a much broader range of decisions that make up the everyday work of key district decision makers. Finally, the diagram and the conversation more broadly about decision making is missing a really crucial element, the organizational context within which decision making unfolds. The nature of decision-making is profoundly shaped by organizational conditions within which it unfolds. And I'm going to talk about just one condition, and that's time, money, and staffing. And I'm talking about the conditions within school districts here. During the 5 years that we studied the large Midwestern school district, this district experienced an acute contraction of resources. The district was forced to cut $20 million from their budget 3 years in a row, which was a nice chunk of change for them. Each year, the central office became leaner. While the responsibilities remained the same, or in some ways increased, there were two consequences of this for district decision making, and by the way, this is the benefit of longitudinal research. First, decision making became increasingly interrupted and drawn out. Conversations about a particular issue or concern would surface, be discussed, and then received from view in the press of competing priorities, only to surface later in the face of a new crisis or impending deadlines. Many issues remained chronically unresolved. Second, the resource constraint led to more conservative decision making. That is, solutions borrowed heavily from pre-existing district practices, the crush of impending deadlines, district personnel tended to reach to the familiar as a basis for solutions. 20% of decisions in the first year of the cuts involved conservative decision making, and we had defined that like a certain way, compared to 57% in the second year and 63% of decisions that we saw in the third year. I should also mention on this, my colleague Caitlin Farrell and I are just about to submit an article that revisits this idea of organizational conditions and how that might matter for districts' use of research and other kinds of guidance from the three district study, which is the more recent study. More specifically, we use the theory of absorptive capacity to look at the conditions that enable districts to learn from external providers. I can talk about this analysis during the question and answer, or if you're going to AERA, Caitlin Farrell is going to present a full-length paper on that. So just a heads up on that. Okay. So these are some of the qualities of decision-making in public agencies, in school district particularly, but they're it's very consistent with research on other kinds of public agencies. What do we know about the role of research in this process? In the conventional view, when policymakers have a problem, they turn to research, which provides missing knowledge. A solution is reached. And there are two assumptions related to the role of research built into this image. One is that the meaning of the research is self-evident. The second is that the main role that the research plays is filling a gap in knowledge at the moment of decision. However, our research, and those done by others, has repeatedly shown that research findings do not speak for themselves. Research use is at root an interpretive process. When people engage in research findings, they must construct their understanding of what they mean. It's these understandings that guide decision making, not the research itself. Furthermore, available research does not always point directly to an appropriate solution. In a given context, there's a lot of space between a given finding and an appropriate action, and interpretive processes play a really important role in that space. People draw on their existing beliefs, knowledges, and values to make meaning of research, and as they draw on implications for solutions. So returning to my example earlier of the middle school mathematics curriculum, the different understanding of the problems were rooted in very different beliefs about high quality mathematics instruction. This understanding appeared to shape different interpretations of the meaning of the low math scores, and also their view of potential viable and appropriate solutions. The conventional image of the role of research also focuses on the instrumental role, as I've mentioned, tends to focus on district leaders consulting research at a main decision point, providing missing knowledge. And indeed, there's certain times where that does happen, where people convene, they look at findings, they make a decision. So that does happen. But there's a broader range of ways that research can be used. Many scholars have documented symbolic use of research. This is when research is used to justify or legitimize a decision that they've already been made, and we have found that as well. And just to illustrate what that might look like, I don't know where that next slide came from. In one of our districts in the three district study, district leaders were redesigning their course sequence in response to the Common Core. The district leaders decided to take this opportunity to do away with the accelerated track in math. Anybody who has kids in middle school knows that this is going to be a very big issue for people. Getting rid of algebra in the eighth grade is what they did, and they got rid of tracking in the middle school. So here, one district leader explains their use of research in a position paper that outlined the case for moving forward with this new plan. It just gave us more evidence, if we needed it, to convince people. A lot of research on tracking was done in the late 70s and early 80s. We needed something more recent. I found this little blurb that Maiko Watanabe wrote in her book, and then I started looking other places, and a lot of people pointed the same research, which was this district in New York. We had Claude Steele's argument around stereotype threat, and how one of the things he talks about is how ability grouping tracking plays a role in stereotype threat. So we had that piece, and Joe Bowler's talks and research all around the causes of inequity and ability grouping. So, two things to point out about this quote. One is that they're clearly using research to justify a decision that they've already made. So that makes it symbolic use of research. But I also want to point out how steeped in research this person is. This is a district director of mathematics. And in this case, knowing this research so well made this district leader a very effective advocate for the new policy for the school board, for parents, and for others in the district. So you can raise a question about whether this is a bad use of research. This is somebody who really read research about issues of tracking and inequity and used it in a variety of ways.
Scholars also point to what Carol Rice calls conceptual use of research. And this is when research concepts or findings provide decision makers with new ideas, new concepts, and new generalizations that influence how they view the nature of the problem or what they see as appropriate kinds of solutions. So here, research doesn't feed a decision directly. Rather, it shapes the beliefs and understandings that decision makers draw on as they consider issues to address in the first place and evaluate potential solutions. And I want to spend a little bit of time talking about conceptual use because this form of research is not well understood. It's also something that we've really struggled with. It's really hard to measure. And during the question and answer, I can talk, we've developed a number of strategies for measuring it. And then the third reason I want to talk about it is the recency effect. We're doing writing on it right now, so it's on my mind. So one of the things that my colleague Caitlin Farrell and I are doing is to try to extend and concretize what conceptual use of research actually looks like. So we've drawn on our findings from the three-year study and also some of my previous work, and we've created a typology of conceptual use. First, research can introduce new concepts. For example, in our research in our three-district study, we asked district leaders across three major districts to name a piece of research that they found useful in the last year, if any, and explain why. This question frequently elicited this kind of conceptual use. So as to illustrate it, one district leader named a researcher and reported, quote, X researcher makes me think conceptually. He wrote an article, which is what got me into multiplication scaling. Stop teaching multiplication as repeated addition. I've cognitively been thinking about what that means, how it could happen, how you could do that. It's a huge mind bender to me. It's more conceptual, I guess. Reading this article causes district leader to think differently about mathematics teaching, and this new insight had a broader impact as well. The leader incorporated these new ideas into the district core curriculum, which they were writing at the time, and also into professional development for teachers. Another form of conceptual use is engagement of research that enables people to see a problem they didn't see before or see a problem in a new light, which is what Carol Weiss emphasized in her work. In my 5-year study of district policymaking, I saw this type of conceptual use when, after discussing research on professional development with an outside provider across multiple years, district leaders began to see their then current approach to professional development as problematic. And I was able to track the shift because we asked district leaders at the start of the study and each subsequent year what in their view constituted high quality professional development. So then we could sort of track changes in their ideas about what is good professional development over time. And what we were able to track was the ways in which this researcher's very specific ideas about high quality professional development worked into their ways of talking about what they saw as high quality professional development. And in fact, they shifted a lot of the ways that they organized professional development. They used it, they moved away from one-shot workshops to professional development that was longer term, that was situated at the school site and situated in the curriculum. These were all consistent with the research on professional development at the time. They also changed district policy to create time during the day. Every week they did a release time for teachers to meet and do professional development. So they ended up over a number of years really restructuring the way that they structured their professional development for teachers. Another kind of conceptual use is that it can help broaden or narrow the understanding about the kinds of solutions that should be considered and which are most appropriate to pursue. I actually sort of told that story already. Returning to the example of professional development, once the district leaders began to see their own approaches as problematic, they started looking at different approaches, which tended to be also focused in that, rooted in that research. Another example of that, actually I'm gonna skip that for time. If you wanna know another example, I can tell you later. Finally, research can also provide a framework to guide action. I talked about this a little bit when I met with the BEST group a second ago, a little while ago. In one district, district leaders read, in one district in our study, oh, so the form of conceptual use is providing a framework to guide action. In one district, district leaders read the book Organizing School for Improvement, Lessons from Chicago Together. This is a book that Tony Breich is first author on. It's a book that's a culmination of many of a longitudinal study of schools in Chicago where they looked at schools that changed and what were the sort of qualities of schools, and they distilled these five essential supports. The district in my study built the five essential supports into their school improvement planning documents. Principals had to talk about how they were addressing each of these five essential supports. They used it to direct researches, resources, and the district leaders reported that it guided what they paid attention to when they visited schools. So these are all forms of conceptual use of research. And why it's important to pay attention to it is that there's some evidence that it's highly prevalent. And there's also evidence that it can have long-term consequences. Rather than influence a single decision, it shapes how people see the world, how they respond to problems they encounter in their everyday work, how they design and manage solutions. So it touches not only policy making, but also policy implementation. So finally, what I was just doing was talking about conceptual research, which is under the big topic of research is used in a lot of different ways that we don't always consider. The final way that I want to talk about is in our three-district study, we identified an additional way in which research can play a role in decision-making, one that we don't see discussed in the existing literature. We call this the development of research habits of inquiry. And after several years of engagement with researchers in these districts, several people in the districts developed ways of investigating the nature of their own challenges that are more typical in the research world than in the practitioner world. So we've observed them routinely questioning empirical evidence for each other's claims. Or discussing strategies for learning about an issue in the district that involves standard research techniques. So for example, I actually did this observation. I was observing a meeting and the leadership in one of our districts decided that they wanted to each interview a teacher to see how they viewed the challenges related to improving middle school mathematics in the district. They decided to randomly select teachers to interview. And during the second meeting about this process, a member of the leadership team had a secure list of randomly selected teachers. And as she was passing them out, the district leaders got an extended conversation about the fact that this approach overrepresented larger schools. And the smaller schools in the district had different issues than the larger schools. So they were worried about the kind of inference they would be making if they just randomly selected them. So they discussed how a sample teacher, they used the word sample, in ways that ensured representation from all of the different kinds of middle schools in the district. So they did a stratified sample. Extended work with researchers in this case seemed to lead to the appropriation of some of the concerns, terms, and habits of inquiry for researchers. Okay, so now I'm going to shift and I'm going to talk about the roles of researchers as a source of research. Again, in the conventional view, the role of researchers is that they provide access to findings. Well, first they make the findings, but sometimes they provide access to the findings as well. And with regards to access, it's important to contextualize this, the idea of direct interaction with researchers compared to the other ways that district leaders gain access to research. So my colleagues at the National Center for Research and Policy Practice, I actually have very little role in a nationally representative sample of research use. They did phenomenal measurement work, tons of stuff. I helped make some of the items, but that's about all I did. So I'm just giving them a lot of credit. One of the things, this was done in 2015, and one of the things this survey asked, they asked leaders to select from 14 different sources where they obtain research relevant to their work. And you'll note that only 15% of researchers, only 15% of respondents said that they got research from university researchers. The most common ways that they got it were via interaction with professional associations, professional conferences, and people in other districts. That's what the top three are. And the thing to sort of pay attention to is the light green and the dark green, which is often and all the time. So these are percentage of the sample who got research in which of these ways. Okay, that is like a super not clear way of representing that. But if you're interested, you can get copies of the study. There's a technical report that you can actually look at this in a little bit more clear way. But the main point is that the main ways that people get access to research is their social and professional networks. Direct contact with researchers is, you know, only 15% of the sample got research that way. But we do know that when people get research from engagement with researchers, or we do know that engagement with researchers increases access. In studies I've done, for example, in my 5-year study in the Midwestern School District, we identified and followed 23 major instructional decisions that unfolded over time. And one of the things we analyzed was when and under what conditions research was invoked in deliberations. And we found that research was much more likely to be invoked by district leaders when there was a researcher involved in the decision process. Indeed, when external researchers were at the table or consulted directly, research was invoked in 11 out of the 12 decisions. When they were not involved, it was invoked in 4 out of the 11 decisions. So in other words, there were 12 decisions where researchers were there, 11 of them involved invocations of research, et cetera. But access does not always lead to substantive use. Again, even when the research partners in the study brought research findings to the attention of district leaders, the research did not always play a substantive role. We found substantive use of research, that is, when research was more than a passing mention, so that's kind of a low bar for substantive use, in only a quarter of decisions where external partners were brought the research to the district attention, and not at all when district leaders invoked research decisions without the involvement of researchers. In subsequent studies, I've looked at school districts involved in these intentional research practice partnerships with researchers, and what I found is that researchers in these partnerships took on roles that went far beyond access, and some of these roles were linked with more substantive use. And so I'm going to identify those kinds of roles that appear to be linked with substantive use. First, researchers fostered use by facilitating sense-making about research findings, their own and other people. And in these cases, researchers did not simply hand over or provide a presentation of their research findings. They facilitated highly structured meetings with district leaders to assist them in making meanings of the findings. For example, each spring, one research partner in our study met with a cross-section of district leaders to engage them in structured discussion of their findings. As part of the discussion, they asked a series of questions to assist the district leaders in thinking about their findings in systematic ways. What does this mean for teachers? What does this mean for school leaders? What does this mean for supervisors of school leaders? What does this mean for upper level district leadership? Same set of questions. It became sort of a routine around a set of findings. Over the course of our study, we saw district leaders increasingly work more intentionally to address some of the issues raised at the multiple levels of the system. And according to district leaders, this systemic approach was not something they did prior to the work with external partners. We also saw district leaders foster research use by bringing research concepts into a co-design process. In the 3-district study of research practice partnerships, we were studying what are called design research partnerships. And those are partnerships where external researchers work together either with district leaders or groups of teachers to design and develop curricula, instructional approaches, professional development, et cetera, to solve district problems. In those partnerships, the researchers then study the use of the tools and use the results of their research to improve the tools, et cetera. The main goal of this work is to make high quality and usable tools that are research-based. But something that we saw in our studies is something else happened as well. The process of working with research ideas in the co-design process fostered conceptual use among the people who were involved in that process, which was, you know, obviously not the whole district, it was usually smaller groups of people. For example, one of the districts was involved with external researchers co-designing instructional strategies to help teachers foster students' ability to engage in mathematical thinking and reasoning in the context of word problems. Over the course of several years, they developed a set of instructional strategies and built that into curriculum units. The district never ended up using the curriculum units, actually. They're very beautiful. You can get them online. But the district mathematics leaders who participated in the co-design process brought a set of concepts about high-quality mathematics instruction into the subsequent work developing the district's response to Common Core, where they have been quite influential. And I mean, we've done an analysis of this, and I can show you how some of these key ideas about the nature of mathematics, thinking and reasoning ended up in the way that they structured curriculum, the curriculum they did end up using for teachers, the way that it ended up being a centerpiece of some of their professional development, how it got built into policy documents. Finally, some external partners play an important role by, I'm not totally happy about this word, so if anybody wants to help me with naming of this, I've been calling it interweaving findings into ongoing district deliberations as they unfold. That is, they help district leaders link research findings to their policies, programs, and issues during the course of active deliberations. Sometimes the researchers made these explicit links in the context of these formal facilitated sense-making conversations I talked about earlier. But more often this happened in one-on-one conversations about problems the district was facing, or when external partners happened to be sitting in on the district conversation. For example, earlier I talked about how the district was working to revise their course sequence in response to Common Core. They ended up getting rid of algebra in the eighth grade, detracking middle school. The germ of the idea that there was maybe a problem with the way that they were teaching algebra, period, and also in light of Common Core rearranges when algebra is taught, came from a one-on-one lunch meeting between the chief academic officer and an external researcher. I heard about this from both parties. Like, the chief academic officer said, yeah, I didn't even realize we had a problem with algebra until X researcher brought that up. This then led to a long, the researcher brought up research findings about the relevant to the development of children's thinking in mathematics and the consequences of failure in eighth grade. They then created this task force that developed the policy document that I showed you, the symbolic piece of research before. But the researcher sat in on that task force when they developed the policy. And while I showed that example of symbolic use of research, then putting research findings onto the, you know, as a way to sell that policy, there are also ways that the researcher was able to link research findings on children's, what's high quality mathematics, the development of children's thinking and reasoning, to the development of that policy as well. So while that was also an example of symbolic use, it was also an example of a district leader, a researcher being at the table with district leaders, making connections to their issues and concerns, providing research knowledge at that time that got built into the actual policy on the front end as well. So the district leaders we interviewed talked about how this and other external researchers acted as thought partners. We see this as going beyond that. It's finding strategic ways to bring research into the conversation and link it to the rhythms of the decision-making process itself. Back to what I said earlier, in order to be able to do that effectively, you have to understand the rhythms of decision-making in a given setting. And so this is a real example of the way that researchers kind of found various points of leverage to bring research findings to bear on very consequential decisions. And this is a school district that has now completely detracted mathematics until 11th grade, which is super unusual. It was very consequential, some of this work. So these are some of the different roles that researchers can play to foster youth. And although I don't have time to get into it right now, we have evidence in our study, some of which is will be presented at AERA, some of which is still in process, that some of this has been pretty influential, some of these roles. So I've covered a lot. What to take away from all of this? One of the key lessons that organizational design professionals have learned is that it's only by understanding the actual rhythms of people's work, the nature of the challenges they face, and how their work is organized, that we gain insight into windows of opportunity to foster change. And one of the key lessons I've learned from studying school districts is that school district leaders want to make the best decisions possible. They want the best information that they can use to make those decisions. But they are making decisions about very complex issues. They're doing so in settings that are unstable, uncertain, and where there's many conflicting pressures and priorities. The question at hand is how to provide the best information possible about issues that district leaders are facing. How can we create the conditions that enable district leaders to use this information productively? And I'm gonna answer that question now. I mean, I think there's a few things that come from some of the research that's been done. First, the literature suggests the need to work to improve the quality of a range of kinds of research. In the U.S., there's been a lot of efforts and resources devoted to improving the quality of educational research in the last decade. Certainly, you know, certainly since I was in grad school, all these best scholars is an example of that. There's been a lot of training programs. There's been a big investment in IS and other places to really have us all step up our game. But most of these resources have been devoted to research on efficacy. And it's been very effective. I mean, I think there's probably some debates about it, but the quality of the research on efficacy now is completely different than it was, for example, when I was in graduate school. There's more educational researchers who are well prepared to conduct our RCTs, or regression discontinuity designs. We know more about what curriculum and programs have a better likelihood of improving student outcomes and which do not. But this represents only a small portion of the kinds of information that educational leaders seek as they work to support schools to improve conditions for kids. In fact, selection and adoption decisions are relatively rare events in the education decision maker's life. They are far more likely to be working on implementation plans, designing programs, planning professional development, considering how they themselves can more effectively support schools, fostering instructional leadership. I think we need parallel efforts to improve the quality of research that can inform those decisions as well. Second, our research suggests that policymakers and researchers could go beyond emphasizing fostering access. Most efforts to encourage greater use have involved creating access to research. That's what the Wetworks Clearinghouse is about, and the creation of a range of technical assistance centers whose job is to translate research findings. But access is a necessary but not sufficient condition for research use. If we want to foster research use, I'd argue we need to address the problem more directly. One way to address use is also to cultivate new roles for researchers. The new roles my colleagues and I have identified mainly involve researchers directly interacting with district leaders. This involves participating in social process and meaning making about research findings. It involves coming into decision processes at multiple stages, finding ways to link research findings, concepts, and research-based tools to district concerns and issues in the context of their existing routines and decision-making structures. It also involves creating new spaces and new routines, like facilitated sense-making or co-design processes, and engaging district decision-makers in them. And it involves asking questions and modeling habits of critically evaluating their own assumptions and ways in which district leaders draw inferences from their own data. And I realize this is a tall order. It's not always realistic for researchers to have this level of involvement in districts, and many local education agencies don't have a university in their backyard. There are currently some different experiments in this realm about how to move beyond these very intensive research practice partnerships to things that are meeting more people's needs, especially there's some virtual experiments, et cetera, that I can talk a little bit about. Some of those, I haven't studied them, but I'm kind of paying attention to them. But I think in terms of direct involvement, there are some different ways that we can all work to foster research use. Fourth, I think there needs to be a greater attention to fostering better conditions for decision making in districts and other public agencies. Part of the challenge is finding ways to create conditions that enable decision makers to engage with new ideas and each other in ways that cause them to question and rethink their assumptions about the nature of problems and to open up to new ideas rather than discount them. In fact, this idea that as the conditions for decision making got worse, people became less open to external ideas and their decision making became more conservative. That's not individual people are conservative and are not open. That's an organizational condition that makes it more likely that individual people are going to be less open to new ideas. So in the districts in our study, this appears to happen when deliberation involved individuals with diverse points of view and enough safety to be able to voice these points of view, enough time in staffing to reach out and investigate new ideas and spend time discussing them with one another, and time to engage with research outside of high-stakes decision contexts. The least productive use of research that I've seen in my study is high-stakes decision context. People use research as a weapon in their arguments with one another. In districts, we studied researchers and at times district leaders created opportunities that brought individuals together to engage with research ideas. In one district, the mathematics department held study sessions where they read research with one another. In another, researchers created carefully designed and facilitated conversation with teams from districts to engage with their research. It was these kinds of occasions where we were most likely to see a conceptual use of research in ways that shaped the direction of decision making more broadly, even though sometimes it was hard to connect that with a specific decision. The fact that I was in these districts over long periods of time helped me see the connections to individual decisions. But if you were to go in for a year, you might say, oh yeah, they're talking about all this great stuff, but to what end? Because you can't, that's not the time scale where some of these kinds of research use actually happened. Educational leaders are working in settings that are frankly not at all conducive to learning, their own learning, or decision making. In order to improve the quality of decision making and the role of research therein, it's important to attend to the conditions for decision making in public agencies as well. So looking forward, I just want to also just say, so what I just talked about was research that's done, mostly published or close to being published. But we're also, just to, you know, in case you're interested, here's some other stuff that we're working on right now. We have a bunch of in-process papers from existing studies. There's a paper that we'll revise and resubmit that's advice to researchers from district leaders on being effective partners. Some of it's the obvious stuff, but there's a whole lot of stuff that I personally never would have thought about, and now makes me like, I'm thinking about this stuff all the time when I'm doing research now. It's trying to be a better partner. Caitlin Farrell and I have a paper that's going to get an ARA and then shortly thereafter submitted to a journal on the role of observative capacity in district learning. This is the one where we look at districts' organizational conditions enable learning and how that interfaces with the kinds of relationships they have with external partners. Some of my colleagues are looking at the role of organizational identity and research practice partnerships. I'm doing some work on conceptual use, what it is, why it's important, how you measure it. We're doing this study that I'm super interested in. I think it's so cool. I don't know if anybody else would find it cool, but we're interested in how images of teaching, how research ideas about the nature and qualities of teachers and teaching become embedded in district policy. So we look at when people invoke certain kinds of images of teachers and how that shapes their strategic decisions and how that results, how that ends up in policy documents at the end of the day. And then we're looking at the nature of argumentation in district instructional decision making and role of different forms of information. And we have two ongoing studies. Actually, it's more than two, but it's just easier to kind of group them this way. We have a study of the role of research in district decision making, individual organizational environmental factors. This is in four large scale. We actually sampled from the 50 largest school districts. We used the survey to select from the 50 largest school districts to sample school districts using a particular sampling frame that I can talk about if you're interested. And the data collection for that will be completed in December 2017. First round of AERA proposals are going in this year, so you have to wait till AERA next year to get the scoop from that. And we're doing a comparative study of three different approaches to research practice partnerships. We're in site selection right now, and we'll start collecting that data. And both of those studies are part of the National Center for Research and Policy and Practice. And you can follow our work in these ways. So thank you. And I have about 30 supplementary slides, so I'm ready for questions. I'm slide, ready to slap up. Or we can just like talk about other stuff.
I've always found what works at Clearing House to be a bit of a mystery.
What's your take? Well, going back to the slide, we provided this information to IES. What works at Clearing House, if you can't see it, 18% of district respondents used what works at Clearing House offer all the time, 37% never.
So what's your take on, there have been huge amount of resources put into it. It's been a huge investment. It's like this output for IES that they really kind of see, you know, as being really critically important to the role, but I'm not seeing
I think that investment is not consistent with research on what we know and how people learn about research findings and how people use it. I don't think IES is the only one that acts in that way. I think we as researchers and research funders,
we often act in ways that are not consistent on research. I mean, we expect other people to use our research, but we do act in ways that are not consistent with prevailing research. But I think, I think the problem with it, or the limitations of it, is first of all, if you know something about how district leaders work, they have like zero time. They have less than zero time. They are so stretched. Every district leader has like 15 jobs. They're behind on everything. They're in schools, they're out of schools, they're dealing with the public. They have no time. They don't have time to go to the What Works Clearinghouse and sort through that and look through it. It's also not part of the norms, their professional norms. It doesn't surprise me at all that the main way that the folks in our national representative sample got access to research was through their professional networks. Think about how you get access to research. The only people who do those Google searches and using search terms are first-year doctoral students who have to do it before they live with you. The rest of us, what do? We talk to people who we know who are experts in that area, and we get recommendations. And that's the way we work, too. And then sometimes we go and we flesh that out using the stuff, especially if we want to publish in RER or something like that. So having a static place that requires people who are super busy and not researchers to reach out and navigate, I think is a lot to ask. The second thing I would say is it depends, I know that the way that they write that stuff up is in very practitioner-friendly language. Research literacy is not great even among researchers, to be honest. So it depends on a lot of knowledge. And then what do you do with these things that you adopt? After you adopt something, these things are not self-winding. They require support. They require, districts have to organize themselves to get them into teachers' hands, to support teachers with them, to create policies around them that you can get a really great curriculum, but if that curriculum is like not linked up with your assessments or in conflict with the other curriculum that the teachers are using and you don't have a sense of that, you're creating mischief with that. So like there's like having a really great efficacy study on a really great curriculum is the first in a very long list of things that districts would need to do in order to use those curriculums in ways that actually get the results that the study suggests are possible. And so, in fairness, I think that the folks at IAS would say, we know we're not dealing with the rest of that stuff before it works. We're dealing with this one part of the problem, which is improving the quality of research and then improving access to it. And I think what works clearing house is a little bit limited with there, but it's also not addressing all these other things as well.
Along with the question of access, there's a lot of talk these days about having open access journals. And if our practitioners had, free access to these journals that cost hundreds of thousands of dollars, and when schools are cutting $20 million in their budgets, they're not going to subscribe to these journals. What is your thought about if we had more open access journals within the education?
I would have the same response, which is that these folks don't go to open access journals. Another slide that I have, they don't search. The way that people get access to research is what comes across their desk. That's why we talked about Twitter earlier. That's why those sorts of mechanisms, as flawed as they are, is more likely to get stuff out than open access. In our national big survey we did, we asked about access to a university library and whether that predicted research use. It did not predict research use. We asked about people who were involved in doctoral programs, that did predict research use. But access to university libraries, which solves the problem, because if you have access to those libraries, you have access. That didn't predict research use. So I like the idea of open access journals. I don't think that's the problem.
I'm wondering what you've observed recently in how research practice partnerships are taking into account your findings and the work that you've been doing. For example, I know Bill Penwell in a recent article has described design-based implementation research and infrastructure, this idea of taking into account organizational conditions so that you can address some of the things.
Yeah, I don't know the answer to that question. I mean, I know you know, I know we provide feedback to the partnerships that we're working. And so Bill is my colleague in the Green District Study and also my colleague in the National Center. The partnerships that we studied, we provided a lot of feedback to, you know, because that's what you do. And I know that they have shifted some of the ways that they do things in response to our feedback, but I don't know how broadly. That would be like super meta. It's me studying the results of my research on the researchers that partnerships lead research. It's like way too. Somebody else can study that. But I don't.
This looks a lot on kind of the relationship with district leaders and how they're implementing policy. Would you say that things are the same when we start thinking about policy kind of at the next level up, when we get to sort of state and federal, or do you think there are other things we should be thinking about there? Kind of, how would you put those together?
Yeah, so I didn't study that.
Just wing it.
The original research that was done on research use in the 70s, Carol Weiss and a number of other people, was done at the federal level. And so, in a way, we were testing their findings in school districts, whether some of their observations about the nature of decision making in public agencies. And we found that their early work in federal agencies, you know, some of those, was very much the same, similar sorts of processes that we saw in school districts. There's some differences because of the way, so I'm really interested in instructional decision making, and so, you know, I can't speak to decision making about the bus schedules or whatever, but instructional decision making in particular is stretched across multiple agencies in a school district. There's the curriculum instruction people, there's the special ed people who are often in the second department than the curriculum instruction people, there's the bilingual department, which is also often in another department, sometimes they're in different geographic locations in the city. And then there's the people who supervise schools, which is nearly always in a different department than curriculum instruction. So you have, that creates a particular set of considerations. These people have different expertise, they have different jobs, they're paying attention to different things, and that creates particular dynamics of decision making. But the overall sort of decisions are a small, set of steps. Sometimes decisions are made without ever formally making decisions. By the way, one of the interesting things that Carol Weiss talks about that we saw is that nobody thinks they make decisions, except the people least involved. Like, you know, I'm the decider, very fortunate. Because there's such a small piece in a long stream of decision making, everybody's like the people higher up will say, well, my staff came to me with blah, blah, blah. And the people who are down are like, I don't have anything to do with it. You know, that's above my pay grade. You know, because it's so stretched out, people don't often see the ways in which the small steps they're taking leads up to something else. And that's something that Carol Weiss talked about and that I very much saw. So the first answer to your question is that I think there's reasons to believe that the nature of public agencies, the kinds of pressures they face, the kinds of tasks that they're doing, leads to certain kinds of processes, decision making and research use that are likely consistent. That being said, states, in the age of ESSA that rolls a lot of stuff down to states, I worry because since financial crisis, but probably even before, states have so little capacity. A lot of states don't really even have full-time people working there. They have some, and then they hire people. They have like huge amounts of people that act as like consultants, but they're doing the core work of states, and they do that because there's like hiring freezes and stuff like that. They gotta get their work done. A lot of people who are at states, their main jobs are administering and monitoring. It's not sort of higher level policy. There are people who do that, but that's not their main job. And states also vary widely in how much capacity they have there. So I worry a lot about things like whether there are people at the state who know a lot about a particular, you know, mathematics instruction, who are responsible for administering, you know, big chunks of change, at least at the moment, in federal government. So that's something, I think capacity issues are, I think they're even worse at the state than they are at the local level. And then you also have the issue that you don't have that immediate feedback. Like people in school district offices, for better or for worse, they're in schools. So they see stuff, and then, like, when you talk about district leaders making meaning of their data, some of that is like test score data. Some of it is the data of their experience. They talk to people, they hear things. People at the state have a harder time getting connected to schools. I mean, they try, especially in big states. It's very hard. So that's an additional, I gotta think that would play a role as well. So, yeah.
So I was thinking that in case of use of research, have you ever looked at, or has there been any study on what's the impact of using tools like checklists and a kind of an imposed use of research in making decisions, whether that predicted the amount of research that was used by people making decisions?
Yeah. Let me see if I have a slide on that. I don't remember. There is a slide. I can't answer the impact question, but if you go to this website and you download the technical report from the survey, one of the things that we looked at was, I'm gonna get this wrong, but it's when do you use research? And one of the categories is when I have to. and there are programs that require, like in order to get grant money, you have to show that your program has efficacy studies for it. And that, if I'm remembering correctly, there was a pretty high percentage of people reported, I mean, we call that imposed use. Carol Weiss also has an article on it that came out in the early 2000s. She doesn't call it imposed use, she calls it something different, but it was at the dawn of when the first Bush, George W. Bush administration, when there started the era of the federal government starting to put things in place to incent and require districts and states to use research more in their decision making. And ReFIRST is a really, people know about ReFIRST, it was a big grant, a big program that was part of No Child Left Behind that was, had a lot of criteria. It was a lot of money for pre-K to 3 reading instruction. It had a lot of very specific requirements about what you could do and the kinds of programs. That's a good example of imposed use. So when people proposed things that they were gonna do, they had to be able to link it to that, And so there's a nice study that Carol Weiss did around that time, not a ReFIRST, but around that time of this new phenomenon of imposed use. My concern about that, is that, people are looking at research when they're making adoption decisions. But often the way that works is that you look at lists of approved programs and stuff like that. So it's not an opportunity for people to learn anything. So it doesn't build capacity in any way. So it would never link to some of like these conceptual. I think it's not likely that it would connect with conceptual use of research. Because it's not like it's actually really having people look at research. It's looking at lists of things that are research approved. That's typically how those programs work. So, yeah.
You mentioned in thinking through instructional decision making and policy application that there's a lot of different departments that come together for that. You mentioned language acquisition, special ed. I'm just wondering, kind of off the top of your head, how often did that come into that conversation, if at all?
How often what?
Get into this education?
In the districts I've been working in?
Yeah.
Not very often. and you know, if you look, all you need to do is look at districts' org charts and who's in what department.
Because I know a lot of times that's like a shared role too.
There's not a lot of staffing for it. Even though I think it's part of Title I monies. If not Title I, I mean, it's part of the federal, there's a gifted ed, correct, funding source. But to be fair, too, like, I wasn't paying attention to that as much. So, like, in the studies we've done, we've tried to identify, like, all the people in the district who are involved in decision-making about mathematics in some way, and it didn't occur to me to talk to the people in the person. So we may be under-reporting it.
Do you have a vision of the ideal of what you'd like to see? I mean, you've, you know, really been thinking about this for a long time. So what's your vision of an ideal use of research and an ideal space for those decisions?
Well, I think, I mean, one of the questions I think none of us have studied is whether using research improves kids' outcomes. Right? And even adopting research-based programs, are those, you know? Like, I think the idea is that you're creating greater odds, but given how many implementation problems that you face, is that really, like, the most effective route toward improving kid outcomes? Because, I mean, you can use research in this range of ways, and you can use research in, like, the most ideal ways. Because, I said this a second ago, you heard it a second ago, policymaking is forward-looking, research is backward-looking. We researchers were saying, this is what happened. Policy is just, like, your best guess at what is most likely to solve a problem. And there are so many other considerations other than research that need to be considered as you move forward in policy to try to make something actually happen. And then there's so many things that, like, intervene in as policy unfolds. So it's very, very hard to say, you know, using research is gonna, like, solve all of our problems. What I feel more comfortable saying is, that using research, especially high quality research, in ways that enable people to kind of really grasp it, think creatively and in in-depth ways about the implications of the research in conversations with each other, and sometimes with researchers, that creates better capacity to make good decisions. You know, so what I think of research use as learning. As an opportunity to learn. And so it's an opportunity to get smarter about the issues that you're facing by learning from places that aren't just your buddy at another district, but remote places, by learning from, you know, decades of scholarship on a particular area and having that tune the judgment that you bring to bear on solving the problems that you have every day. And so that then suggests, well, then how can we create conditions for better problem solving? Because you can tune your judgment in these great ways and not be able to get the right people in the same room ever, so you make this a totally last minute conversation. So that's one point. But the other is creating, you know, as researchers, creating opportunities for our work to reach the people that it needs to work at the moment when they need to have it. And providing ways to talk both about this exact decision, but also ways to learn from these findings and ways that create greater capacity over time. So I think a lot of the time we think about this in terms of one decision, instead of thinking about how that one decision fits into a broader stream of work and a broader stream of problem solving. A lot of what decision makers are doing is they're problem solving. And how can we help use research to help people be better problem solvers? And have better tools to use in their problem solving. I don't know, that's, like, probably fairly vague, but that's how I think about it.
Yeah, so following up on that, and, you know, it occurred to me when you put up the slide that related to how people find out about research, and so a little of it comes directly from researchers, but you would imagine that research that researchers have produced indirectly flows through many of those other vehicles that you described. Have you all looked at the different messages that the same research, if you filter this through a conference, that the people who put the conference together are drawing on the same research, but they're picking things. So I'm reluctant to call it bias, but the fact that people will take from a given research paper different things, and of course then the implications are quite different for practice.
Absolutely.
So I'm interested in some non-normative way of trying to understand whether the method by which people come to understand research, how much that influences what they believe about so-called research.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a huge thing. And if you want to, somebody should study right now grit, if they want to study that phenomena in action. I mean, every school district I'm in is suddenly really interested in grit, and they're doing some very interesting things to try to measure grit or support kids or build grit. And then there's the grit backlash because it's, you know, it's not taking kids' needs seriously. It's contributing to stereotype thing, kids, blah, blah, blah. But that's a growth mindset, same thing, right? These are ideas that are out there. They are out there. They are in school districts. There are people who are making their money shopping those things that have who are not related to Angela Duckworth or Carol Dweck, right? At the end of the day, like, these are the processes that are in play, that we work in part of. I think there's a really interesting book that I haven't read in a while, so I'm making this quote again, by Jack Schneider, who is a historian of education, and he studied sort of, you know, over decades, ideas that became very, very, very central to the way public schools do their business that have roots in research. He studies the development of the Carnegie Unit, as an example, and he studies one of the things he looks at is Bloom's taxonomy. And I think there are lessons to be learned. I mean, the meaning of these things are always going to be unstable, but there are lessons to be learned about when meaning is sort of more held on to versus like totally misused everywhere and gone nuts. And it has to do with, if I'm remembering correctly, sort of these ideas get built into sort of multiple different forms. They get built into curriculum. They like become part of professional networks. What else, but there's sort of like, if it's all rooted in like a single investigator and then hits, you know, the Twitter sphere, like one would predict that would not hold meaning in quite the same way. I think there's lessons to be learned. I don't know if people are, I've not studied this, I'm just sort of an observer of it. If people know about reading recovery and the way that reading recovery is organized, does anybody know about reading recovery? This is not going to be very meaningful, but reading recovery is a program that has a lot of research linked to it. And what's amazing about reading recovery is if you go into reading recovery, they're not classrooms because it's a pull-out program. If you look at reading recovery practitioners in many, many different locations, it looks roughly the same. And so then there's a question, and the ideas of reading recovery have been built into assessments that many urban districts now use. They call it FNP, the Common Practice. Assessments. I mean, its influence has spread behind, beyond them. But the way that they scaled up that research-based program, they had a central place at Ohio State. Then they had regional training centers. Then they had requirements for districts that built on that they needed a district reading recovery coordinator who was trained from one of these regional places. The district reading recovery coordinator trained the reading recovery folks. The district has to agree to ongoing monthly professional development, they call it behind the glass, where all the reading recovery teachers watch other reading recovery teachers teach, provide them with feedback. This is for the lifetime of the innovation. And the meaning of that research-based innovation has held for decades. Okay, so that's a lot, but I think there are lessons to be learned from instances like that, about the infrastructure that supports continuity of meaning across time and space. So I guess that's one thing I would say. But we're meaning makers, all of us are. I mean, we misunderstand and misinterpret each other's researchers, and we all have, you know, PhDs, or almost half of PhDs. So it's, you know, this is part of the human condition. And then the question is sort of, what are some things we can put in place to have that meaning-making be constrained in some ways that all true? I also think the other thing is like, these quick touches with ideas. You go to a professional conference, you go to one workshop, and then you come home and you create a whole program around it, the likelihood that that program is going to resemble at all what you learned in the professional conference is rather small. We have 15 minutes, right?
So a lot of what you spoke about today is the district level decision makers, and I know some of your other work has really looked at how teachers interpret decisions, and I'm interested to hear how you connect those two pieces.
Yeah, so the work at the school district level has been more about policy making. And the work that I've done with teachers has been more about policy implementation. So I've actually not done studies, I would love to, but I've not done a study where I've looked at, here are policy making processes, now what's going on at the school level. They've been separate studies. But I think the sense making processes and the social nature of the sense making processes, again, it's like the core processes I don't think are different. What's different is the set of conditions that, the organizational conditions that influence those processes. So, you know, district leaders are busy, teachers are rather really busy, you know, and, but also teachers have this direct feedback thing that happens. You know, they can try stuff out in their classroom and get pretty quick, sometimes too quick feedback, you know, because they act like too quickly in response to the, I tried it once, didn't work, I'm not going to do this, you know. So that's how I would sort of think about what is the difference. In our current study of four districts, one of the things we're interested in is the relationship between district decision making and school decision making. And so my previous studies have been only at the district level decision making. So I'm kind of interested and excited to see, we sampled schools that had more or less connection with the subject matter departments, the studies in ELA and math. And so we have schools where the district is like in their face and schools that are relatively independent from the district. And we're looking at their decision processes related to a similar, we're calling them lines of work. So like if the district is rolling out a set of curriculum units, we looked at that decision process at the school level, and now we're looking at school leadership teams and how they're making decisions about these curriculum units. So, you know, we finished that. We're finishing the school level data collection this spring, and then we should analyze the data, so wait and see.
So I, a lot of the, you know, the work that you've done and presented here sort of relates to, you know, what we sort of objectively know about the role, the relationship between what researchers do and what practitioners take from that. And, you know, the impetus seems to be, and there's sort of growing acceptance of this in the field, you know, the more formal researcher-practitioner partnerships and so on, is that researchers should be more engaged. And I'm wondering if you could reflect on that in the context of the incentive structure that exists at universities, specifically, but other places where people with PhDs sit to actually engage in that kind of relationship. And, you know, I don't think the slide you presented about the very low level of information that comes directly from researchers to practitioners is at all surprising. And so before too many PhD students decide, yes, this is my next, where I want to head, I'm wondering if you could reflect a little bit on that perhaps misalignment of incentives.
Yeah, before I reflect on the misalignment of incentives, the other thing I should say is like, I don't think that every researcher should be involved in research practice partnerships. I don't think every researcher should, you know, like I think there's a lot of ways of doing good research. And like I'm not like all of us should be out working side by side with school districts. Not all of our research lends itself to that, but not all researchers, like I don't want some researchers in school districts. I mean, my experience of doing research in school districts is I'm busy cleaning up other people's messes all the time. You know, like that there's a lot of bad behavior. which reflect, I mean, I think that that reflects badly on those of us who train researchers, that we don't provide opportunities for people to come to understand these settings that we're working in. We don't know enough about how these folks do their work to learn how to enter into it in ways that are productive. Doing research in settings takes a lot of district leaders' time. And so it's only worth it for them if we're good citizens and we create research that is supportive and useful and helpful. So therefore, the onus is on us to really learn how to do that, to how to work productively, how to be respectful, how to make sure what we're doing makes a difference for folks. And I mean, like, I don't think oh, all of us need to do this kind of work. But what I do think, because of, you know, kinds of things that you say, is that there, I was at a, last year's AERA in DC, there was an education dean's conference, and I got invited to give a talk there. And in the setting, like in the round tables when all these different deans were like talking to each other, they were all sort of like, oh, so-and-so researcher on my staff, that's the person who does this work. They're a hero. They do all this stuff. They go above and beyond. They're at schools and they're research productive and they do all this stuff. And I felt like the education deans were really locating this as like it's individual will. That the problem is like researchers need to want to do this somehow or something like that. But in fact, you'd make it more likely that people who wanted to do this work, who wanted to try this work, or who might be good at this work, or so they could be successful if the nature of our work was organized in a different way. And so the researchers who tend to do this work, anybody who's done a lot of close-in work with schools or school districts, you know, a huge amount of time has to be put into building these relationships, creating, having really good communication, creating routines for interacting and engaging. And you build that by yourself each time you work with a school district. I could imagine schools of education, the school, having, investing in, and building infrastructures that stretch between a school and a district. I could imagine thinking about how you count, that work is not counted as service, but that work is counted as, which those of you who don't know, doesn't count for much. You just need to do enough that people don't get pissed at you other than you come up for tenure. So that's some other category that's more closely linked to the stuff that we are held accountable for. So I think that there are ways that schools of education or other schools could develop infrastructure that would make it more likely that more people could be engaged in this way, that they could be successful when they're engaged in this way, that they, you know, can get the capacity building that I think researchers need in order to be able to do this work well. At the moment, it's all on individual researchers, and you do it a little bit at your peril. I mean, you have to, the people who do this work publish less. And that's often. Because they spend time meeting with districts. I mean, like, I don't even do research practice partnership, but I'm just very committed to doing feedback. The amount of, nobody sees the analysis and the presentation, not to mention the time that it takes to negotiate that, to have those conversations. I mean, I have a very close relationship with the school district. They could be my full-time job, the amount of time that they reach out to me and want to talk to me, and I want to talk to them, right? Nobody sees that. It doesn't go in my annual review. Nothing, right? So, like, I think it's a structural problem with the organization of our work, not individual stuff.
Yeah. What you were just talking about, it really strikes me as the concept of a research knowledge broker. I'm sure you're familiar with this idea. You know, these are university-based folks who spend a lot of time building relationships with policymakers. They all have, you know, they've been studied, and they all have tenure, which is related to Jim's point. You know, but these are people that really, the interesting thing about people who have been studied to do this, they're trying to translate and make use of not only their own research, but other research. So I was sort of relating that back to the workforce clearinghouse idea. So if you have research knowledge brokers, where would they go to make sure that the research that they're talking about is valid if it's not their own research and they're not familiar with it? Perhaps they could go to some place like the Public Health Clearinghouse, so that would still serve a role, not directly to practitioners, but not going to go directly to them, but perhaps to the research.
Yeah, and I think, you know, when I think about like schools of education, I think probably, like if I were to design one of these things, not everybody involved would be a tenure line faculty member. Like you want very smart practitioners to be involved in this work. Like and then the research practice partnerships I've studied, there are often like a very, very smart practitioner who's kind of interested in research and reads research. Sometimes that person is in the district, right? And they're the main contact that you have in the district. Sometimes that person is hired by the whatever the entity is, and you want to be able to work in collaboration. Like you can't do this work as a solo practitioner, as a solo research practitioner. You can't. And like we would do this work better, I think, if we had new roles for people to play in this process, more akin to the kind of knowledge broker role.
Is that, I mean, so that the interweaving thing, is that sort of what you were thinking of there?
I could imagine that in our studies it was researchers who were at the table doing that, but I could imagine somebody playing that role as well. In a way, the RELs, the regional education labs, are intended to play that kind of role. They're part of the translational research idea, and I don't spend a lot of time with them, but the buzz I hear is they do more or less good job of that. That there are some that are doing very interesting things, and there's some that aren't. And I know that part of the What Works Clearinghouse was to try to, like, in the same time that IES was doing What Works Clearinghouse, they really changed the way the RELs were organized, and they tried to kind of control what research the RELs were translating more. The other thing I know, just because like I have a friend who works at a REL, is like now they're doing these networked improvement community things, they're working with networks. They're running like 7 networks. Each network has, you know, 10 to 15 school districts or states. I mean, it's just like what they're being asked to do is, it's solving the problem of these really boutique Chicago and the consortium, just one district. It's trying to create these kinds of opportunities for reaching a broader range of districts, which, I don't know, I was talking last night with folks about rural districts. I mean, you're never going to have a research practice partnership like the Chicago Consortium in rural districts and have, you know, 3 people working at the district level. You know, you need to have a different solution, and that kind of structure might be the better solution for it. But what they're being asked to do, the volume of it, is really jaw-dropping when you think about what it takes to do this work well.